क्लास वन में मैं छह साल का था और मे बी दैट शेप्ड मी बिकॉज आई वाज सो मी एंड आई वाज अ बिट ऑफ अ लूनर इन ऑन माय फर्स्ट डे इन स्कूल इन क्लास वन आई गॉट बीटन अप तो अ बंच ऑफ किड्स हु न्यू ईच अदर एंड दे बुलीड द फक आउट ऑफ मी मेरा पहला एक महीना क्लास वन में बहुत ट्रॉमेटिक था तो मेरी मम्मी ने क्या की मेरी मम्मी ने कहा कि बेटा मैं तो आकर लड़ूंगी नहीं तुम्हारे लिए तुमको लड़ना पड़ेगा तो उसने मुझे कराटे क्लास में डाला तो छह की उम्र से मैं कराटे सीखने लगा एंड एट द एज ऑफ 12 आई एम द अंडर 12 नेशनल चैंपियन तो इन दो सिक्स इयर्स आई बिकेम अ कराटे चैंपियन तो दैट मस्ट हैव शेप्ड मी एंड टेकन मी आउट ऑफ दैट स्केयर्ड ऑफ द वर्ल्ड एंड नॉट श्योर इफ आई कैन रियली टेक ऑन द वर्ल्ड काइंड ऑफ किड एंड स्लोली आई ग्रो अप टू becoming what you may see as a rebellion on the outside I see as just being a little more courageous to explore
so I would like to ask you about your early artistic influences and because you have indulged in other forms of art as well apart from cinema what were the things that you were indulged in
main film buff nahi tha I most of my influences continue to be art and literature and comics for the longest time I was very influenced by the graphic novel medium and I even considered cinema because cinema seemed like the closest next thing to the graphic novel medium and in India till the early 2000s the graphic novel medium was not taken seriously enough ye pichle 10 se 15 saal mein hi kuch logon ne us medium mein apni artistic expression explore karne ki koshish kari hai so back then that was not an option so I just veered towards cinema but I have not been a film buff so if I have to make a list of my cinema influences there'll probably be none primarily I'm making film because I am very interested in exploring sound and color and image and performance and all kinds of things that sort of come together to make cinema so my influences and also being born and growing up in Calcutta for whatever that city is not a lot of things but it is quite a melting pot of artistic culture so it gives you that sort of exposure very early on there is a very rich exchange of literature and art and music from the time you're 6 or 7 years old you can't escape it so it gives you that it shows you the possibilities that you can do that the things that you can do with your life because similar to me there were I mean the same age I had friends and cousins in Bombay Delhi Bangalore as I was growing up and that artistic exposure a lot of them were not getting the kind that I was getting in Calcutta and it's not like my family had any art my father used to sell sarees so I wasn't exposed to that art within my family but that city sort of showed me the possibilities that I could explore with my life but when it came to wanting to do everything art and music and poetry and creating images the only medium that sort of offered itself up to me was cinema and for that I sort of the next obvious thing was to come to Bombay so somewhere I think that I won't call it a variety as much as I call it confusion I've been very confused about what really it is I want to dedicate my life to so cinema allows me to dabble in all these things so I'm doing cinema but if at some point even now an alternative crops up that might excite me more than cinema I'll drop cinema like a hot potato and fuck off
because you mentioned about certain city wala influence I have also felt the I've actually been the exact opposite of what you have grown with I'm from Surat so yahan to artistic culture wala cheez to utna prevalent nahi raha hai but for me when that thing came up which is just a few years ago I completely gobbled it up and tried to do sahat type of art mein I was trying to just indulge and read and you know consume in every form possible but ek sense of rebellion rehta hoga shayad you know early years in some way or the other sometimes it can manifest in ways like for example it can manifest in a manner that agar aapke life mein artistic influence aa bhi raha ho as like growing up you might consider it as you know something taken for granted ya fir ek constant hai ye cheez so like a few of the people I've talked to have also mentioned that they developed this sort of rebellion against wanting to watch films or read books because wo itna ek family mein ya fir unke surroundings mein uska itna zyada uska ek influence tha so any sort of rebellion phases that you remember maybe artistically or otherwise growing up
none really I come from a very 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 simple lower middle class family that had very little exciting things happened in our lives. And so everyone was following the right beats in their lives and just going through life, going through the motions. So rebellion to nahi, but I remember being a very, very, the opposite of rebellion. I was a very meek and scared child. Main bahut jaldi dar jata tha. Aur I couldn't talk to strangers. I should think 10 times before crossing the road. Meri phatti thi, but when I was a kid. So main jab ये बहुत हाल ही में मुझे रियलाइज हुआ कि एक चीज हुई थी मेरे साथ क्लास वन में. मैं 6 साल का था, 5.5 साल का था, और मे बी दैट शेप्ड मी. आई डिडंट रियलाइज इट फॉर द लॉन्गेस्ट टाइम. नाउ सिंस यू आस्क्ड दिस, मे बी आई विल शेयर दैट. आई डोंट नो इफ इट वाज रिबेलियन, बट बिकॉज आई वाज सो मीक एंड आई वाज अ बिट ऑफ अ लोनर, इन ऑन माय फर्स्ट डे इन स्कूल इन क्लास वन आई गॉट बीटन अप. तो अ बंच ऑफ किड्स हु न्यू ईच अदर, मे बी केम फ्रॉम फैमिलीज दैट वर फैमिली फ्रेंड्स और व्हाटएवर, they got together and I don't know, they saw that he was a potential victim and they bullied the fuck out of me. Matlab mera khana kha lete, mere laces bandh dete, main trip karke gir jata, fir haste mujh pe. To bahut sari cheeze hui aur wo pehle ek mera pehla ek mahina class 1 mein bahut traumatic tha. To meri mummy ne kya ki, meri mummy ne kaha ki beta main to aakar ladungi nahi tumhare liye, tumko ladna padega. To usne mujhe karate class mein dal diya. To 6 ki umar se main karate seekhne laga and at the age of 12 I'm the under 12 national champion. So in those 6 years I became a karate champion. So that must have shaped me and taken me out of that scared of the world and not sure if I can really take on the world kind of kid, and slowly I grew up to becoming what you may see as rebellion. On the outside I see as just being a little more courageous to explore. So that right. little bit of courage that you need to just go out there, go outside the known perimeters of the life that you recognize and explore things that are out of your comfort zone, that you may have read about, but you have no idea how you will react to them or what they will do to you. So somewhere that courage to explore came from my 10, 11 years of karate. I never realized it till recently. I was thinking about ki मेरी फटती थी जब मैं बच्चा था, ये कहाँ से आया कि मैं एक जनरल कंपार्टमेंट में बैठ गया बिना रिजर्वेशन के और 24 घंटे में डिसाइड किया मेरे को बॉम्बे जाना है, मैं बॉम्बे आ गया. आई डिडंट हैव अ प्लेस टू स्टे, आई डिडंट हैव एनी फ्रेंड्स, आई डिडंट नो वेयर टू फकिंग बिगिन, स्लेप्ट फॉर 3 नाइट्स ऑन गोरेगांव स्टेशन. आई हैव ऑल द प्रेडिक्टेबल बीट्स ऑफ द स्ट्रगल स्टोरी. हाउ डिड आई डू दैट व्हेन आई हैड टू बी सो स्केयर्ड टू इवन गो टू अ शॉप एंड टॉक टू अ शॉपकीपर इफ आई डिडंट हैव समवन अकंपनिंग मी. सो इट मस्ट हैव बीन द 10 इयर्स ऑफ कराटे.
अबाउट यू कमिंग टू मुंबई एंड दैट एंटायर फेज, हाउ डिड इट हैपन एग्जैक्टली?
लाइक आई सेड, आई वाज कंफ्यूज्ड. So school mein I used to write a lot. Maine apni pehli kitab class 8 mein likhi hai jo kabhi chhapi nahi aur maine phaad ke phenk diya kuch saal pehle. Kitab likh li, poetry bahut likhta tha. I was the lead singer of my school band. I was in the school dance team. I was the captain of the school karate team. Matlab main har cheez mein apni ungli ghusata tha. So by the time school ended I'm like are main ek cheez nahi kar sakta, mere ko ye sari cheeze karni hai. To वो सारी चीजें करने की गुंजाइश कैलकटा में तो नहीं मिलती आपको. तो फिर मैंने व्हेन यू आर लीविंग स्कूल, आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट 1998-99 व्हिच इज लाइक 4 generations बैक. नाउडेज एवरी 5 years इज अ जनरेशन अनलाइक अर्लियर. तो तब या तो आप मेडिकल करते हो या इंजीनियरिंग करते हो या एमबीए देते हो. तो मैंने सारे इंजीनियरिंग एंट्रेंस एग्जाम्स दिए, मैं सब में ढेर हो गया. आई डिडंट गेट इन एनीवेयर. देन आई स्टडीड इकोनॉमिक्स. आई डोंट नो व्हाई आई डिडंट हैव इकोनॉमिक्स इन स्कूल, बट आई डोंट नो व्हाई आई डिड इकोनॉमिक्स. आई डिड इकोनॉमिक्स एंड देन बाय द टाइम इकोनॉमिक्स वाज एंडिंग 65 people in my class and 64 of them are preparing for their CAT exam. So maine bhi 2 hafte thoda preparation karke maine de diya CAT exam. I made it to the first list of IIM Bangalore. I'm like, oh, I didn't plan for this. Ab kya karu? So luckily they needed a whole lot of money as a deposit. So fees, pehle saal ka fees aur paise nahi the mere paas. Maine bola, bhaad mein jaye mujhe to chahiye bhi nahi tha. To meri family ki to phat gayi the. Are, tere ko IIM Bangalore mil gaya aur tu itne halke mein de raha hai. ऐसे मिल गया पर चाहिए नहीं था. तो चाहिए नहीं था कभी तो कुछ वैल्यू होना चाहिए ना. तो बैक देन आल्सो डैम कंफ्यूज्ड. सो आई डिड माय मास्टर्स इन इकोनॉमिक्स फॉर अ मंथ एंड देन आई क्विट दैट. देन आई जॉइंड द न्यूज़पेपर एज अ क्राइम जर्नलिस्ट फॉर 2 months. देन आई क्विट दैट. देन आई वांटेड टू डू अ लिटिल आर्ट एंड अ लिटिल राइटिंग. सो आई वेंट टू एडवर्टाइजिंग. तो मैं 2.5 साल एडवर्टाइजिंग में था एंड आई वॉज रेडी टू स्लिट माई रिस्ट्स. आई एम लाइक, दिस इज नॉट व्हाट आई वांट टू डू. आई डोंट वांट टू बी टेलिंग पीपल दैट दिस ब्लैक ड्रिंक with bubbles in it is good for you and you should be buying it. Sir, ye mere se nahi hoga, puri zindagi nahi kar paunga. So then a couple of my friends were coming out of National Institute of Design, NID. To wo keh rahe the ki Bombay mein film karenge. To I said, film to mujhe pasand bhi nahi hai, to dekhna bhi pasand nahi hai. Matlab wo 2 ghante bhi, tab mujhe lagta tha ki main 2 ghante zaya kar raha hu film dekhkar, kitab na padh lu. Main bola theek hai, try karte hain. But because I wanted to get out of the life I knew so badly, that I decided on a Thursday, I sat in a general compartment on a Friday and I was in Bombay on a Saturday. If I had not left that Thursday, if I had waited for Friday, I may not have been in Bombay. It was that impulsive. So, uske baad jo papad bele humne yahan pe wo bele, wo jo har struggler jo karta hai, at least us zamane mein, wo sari cheezein hui. Bahut predictable struggle story hai. Khane ke bande the, do vada pav pe survive kiya, wo sab ki kahani hai, at least us zamane mein. So, wo sari cheezein hui mere saath.
Most of your films have this element of you wanted to say something more than just the story. Like there's more theme or there's more or bhi kafi politics involved hoti hai film mein. Socio-political aspects, context bahut rehta hai film mein. I want to understand uska roots kahan pata hai. Any of your readings earlier, jahan pe aapne aise kuch cheeze padhi ho, ya fir wo uski awareness kahan se aana shuru hui? Kya aapko when you were writing earlier, usme bhi aise kuch layers the?
To ye bhi na, I mean, when I, the first 8-10 years in Bombay when I was writing aur meri filmein nahi ban rahi thi. 18 filmein meri shelve hui kuch 6-7 saal ke period mein. 2009 tak, 9-10 tak. Tab, you know that what you're asking requires a very high level of self-awareness and, you know, self-reflection. Aur us waqt when you're wo jaddo-jahed mein lage hue, aap junoon sawar hai ki likhna hai, banana hai, tab wo itna self-awareness rehta nahi hai. But later, when my film started getting made and I started actually being asked these questions a lot, I started reflecting on where is this coming from? Why am I so angry inside with how the social and political state of things, primarily in this country, because I don't understand the nuances, the socio-political nuances of other countries. So I refrain from commenting, but why am I so angry and why even when I'm trying to tell a love story or something abstract, even there, some or the other sociological or political comment sort of slips through. So when I thought about it, I might be wrong. Like you said, sankalp ki wo kuch cheeze hain bachpan ki jo hum yaad rakhna chahte hain aur kuch cheeze yaad nahi rehti. To shayad ye selective memory hai, I don't know, but I traced it back to one particular night. So on the 6th of December 1992, if there's anyone here who's not aware of what happened that night, the Babri Masjid fell. I was one of three Hindu families in a predominantly Muslim, Bangladeshi Muslim slum in Calcutta. My entire childhood has been spent there. So my friends and the kids I went to karate class with and the kids I learned to ride scooters with were all Muslim. And the Bangladeshi Muslim. That night, something happened. In the evening, the masjid fell and tab TV par bhi itna, matlab TV ka access itna nahi tha, matlab pure mohalle mein shayad do ya teen TVyan hongi. Hum padosi ke ghar pe jaakar Sunday ko kuch dekhte the ya Wednesday raat ko Chitrahar dekhte the. So the only access was radio and the radio had a blackout at one point and no news was coming. The only thing that were coming were these snatches of rumors ki ye hua hai wahan pe Bombay mein dange ho gaye, Ayodhya mein dange ho gaye. और वो खबर अलग अलग जगह पे अलग अलग तरीके से आ रही थी और रात तक दंगे हो गए. कुछ हुआ उस रात. मेरे मोहल्ले में हम तीन फैमिलीज को एक बड़े से मॉब ने अटैक किया और उस वक्त सिर्फ मेरी माँ और मैं थे. मेरे माय फादर एंड माय सिस्टर वेंट देयर, दे हैड ट्रैवल्ड टू बैंगलोर फॉर समथिंग. एट सम पॉइंट द एयरफोर्स केम एंड द एयरफोर्स सॉर्ट ऑफ केम एंड इम्प्लीमेंटेड अ कर्फ्यू इन आवर एरिया. तो थिंग्स डिडंट गो आउट ऑफ हैंड बट माय मदर ऑलमोस्ट गॉट रेप्ड दैट नाइट एंड आई ऑलमोस्ट गॉट किल्ड एंड आई गॉट I remember the one thing that I remember very vividly. I was 12 and I was preparing for my class 7 exams. And ye December ka mahina tha, to wo, I think December mein hi wo second semester ke exams hote hain. And we all huddled on this little second floor terrace. Aur sare gate wait lock kiye, but humko pata tha ki hum bachenge nahi bahut der, kyunki wo bamboo ki lambi seediyan hoti hai na, jisse wo street lights repair karte hain. तो वो सीढ़ियां आने लगी गलियों के अंदर से एंड दे स्टार्टेड क्लाइंबिंग द बिल्डिंग. तो हम बस अटैक ही होने वाले थे और मैंने किचन से एक चाकू ली थी अपने साथ एंड आई वाज इन दिस कॉर्नर, इन दिस डार्क कॉर्नर, जस्ट ट्राइंग टू मोटिवेट मायसेल्फ कि अगर मैं अटैक हुआ, किसी ने मेरे माँ को छूने की भी कोशिश की, मैं चाकू से उस इंसान को तो मार दूं. एंड व्हेन आई थॉट दैट आई पिस्ट माय पैंट्स 3 times. सो लॉन्ग स्टोरी शॉर्ट, द पॉसिबिलिटी ऑफ द वायलेंस दैट नाइट अफेक्टेड मी सो मच that I didn't think about it for the rest of my school or college life. But when I actually came to another city and started probably going through the motions of being insecure, not knowing what my future holds for me, then you start getting connected with deeper feelings. And you start, when you're sitting down to write your stories, you're trying to look for connections with the characters that you're writing about. You start delving deeper and deeper. And this kept coming back. What I felt that night, the fear, the rage, the anticipation of violence. And somewhere, probably that night has shaped my voice for life. Because if you see Agli Baar or you see Absent or even Taandav, there is an anticipation of violence. Most of the violence really happens in 2 seconds. I'm not interested in the fetishizing of that violence or lingering on it. I'm just interested in the anticipation, because half the time that destroys us. So maybe it came from that night, and maybe that rage against the current government and the overall system is so strong inside me because of what could have happened that night.
Firstly, thank you for being able to share that with us. Despite this being some sort of a personal experience for you, there is still in your films, apart from your own personal perspective, shayad dusre communities or dusre genders or phir dusre alag type ke logo ke perspective rehte hain, alag tarikon ke rage rehte hain, alag tarikon ke socio-political exploration rehte hain. And obviously, I will talk about the experiments with your camera separately, alag se. But ek exploration rehta hai hamesha se, which is not probably, doesn't feel that personal when we think about it. But how much of you is there in each of these films, which apparently it might not seem ki ye aap ho? Is it just you trying to explore different sections of society, or is it just you coming out in different manners?
Neither. I just, when I sat down to write stories, I realized that my rage somewhere is also probably self-directed, because a lot of us, and now what I'm going to talk about is takes into consideration everything: caste, class, religion. Now, given that I'm living in a Hindu majority country, and unfortunately, I was born into a family that considers itself upper class, upper caste, and I was born with certain privilege, because I didn't really have to struggle for food every day. I saw a father who went on a very safe, secure scooter to a very safe, secure shop, sold sarees and came back. And the confines of my home were fairly secure. I mean, I didn't have to really face anything extreme in my daily life. So given that, I didn't really have to grapple with things that more than 90% of the population of this country have to grapple with on a daily basis. Plus, I'm not a woman, so I have it very easy. Women have it way more difficult in a country like ours than men do. So on all counts, I'm in some sort of a privileged class. So that anger slowly started getting directed at myself. That is, the situation in this country is like this. Someone from people from my class, a male, upper caste, Hindu, privileged chutia, is probably most responsible for anything that's fucked in this country. So I got least interested in my own story. I got more interested in the classes that I don't represent. Every time I get into a, like you in the offline abstract room screening, I get into a dialogue with someone from one of those classes, and they question me on my choices in my storytelling, because I'm not representing myself. I'm representing classes that I don't belong to and I cannot claim to know and the inner perspective of. So often when I get put in the dock, all I have for them is apologies, because I am appropriating narratives which are not my own, because I'm not interested in my narrative. So somewhere my anger is probably being rooted through the anger of the marginalized. It's a very loose term, marginalized, but you know what I mean. Yeah. Any section except me, because I consider myself from the most, you know, entitled lot in this country. So if I'm channeling my rage through those narratives, then those narratives are not my own, but I'm not interested in my own narrative. So if I want to tell stories, then how do I tell stories? I have to appropriate someone else's narrative. So I go around trying to do that as carefully and respectfully as I can, but I often don't get it 10 out of 10. I get one or two things wrong. So I hope that then my films start that dialogue. And from film to film, I see myself also growing as a storyteller. Maybe I'll grow closer to those perspectives, but I don't claim to get any of those perspectives bang on in this lifetime, because I've not lived those lives. But broadly, that anger that you speak of, over time started getting directed towards myself. And for me, my films are therapy. I have to channel it outwards, otherwise I'll end up self-destructing.
I completely relate to the, I mean, I don't know if you see it in the same manner or not, but at this stage of my life, having been trying to exploring different structures, generally speaking, about the world. So I've been feeling this sense of guilt in some way or the other because of a similar background as to yours, coming from there, feeling that I have been unaware or, you know, unseen. I've been blinded by a lot of things around me. I've not seen those things. So a sense of wo rehta hai ki, you know, should I overcompensate? Like, I end up overcompensating at times for feeling guilty. Like, aapko kabhi, waise aapko negotiate karne mein dikkat hoti hai in your writing in any way? that because you're talking about somebody else and you are trying to sort of, it's towards you, it's attacking you in a sense, or your identity that you have been carrying through your life.
Yeah, all the time. So when I use the word appropriation, and I'm aware that I'm using it very glibly and very loosely, because I've reached a point now where before someone else accuses me of appropriation, I accuse myself. And I'm like, you know what? I admit before you accuse me, so that we can leave this behind and get on with the rest of the discourse. So when I'm writing or trying to tell these stories, so especially when you're working with such stories in film. Now, for example, I see Kamal here. Kamal was my second AD on the film that I just made called Joram, in which Manoj Bajpayee plays an Adivasi who used to be an Naxalite, and he's on the run. The system's running after him. Now, that film is made by a non-Adivasi. The lead, which is an Adivasi character, is played by a non-Adivasi. Almost the entire crew, a lot of the cast are Adivasi. We tried to represent the Adivasi as much as possible in the local casting in Jharkhand, but most of the crew is non-Adivasi. So when I am trying to create so many things there, the colors, the costumes, the jewelry, the sounds, the smells, the props, the elements of that world, the chances of going wrong are infinitely increasing, because I'm not just putting text on paper, I'm literally creating that world. So the level of apology and the level of overcompensation is infinite, because at every step I'm like, dude, we can't get this wrong, let's overcompensate. And in the overcompensation, new mistakes get made. So that's all I have to say in my defense every time is I'm a work in progress. So all of this is a work in progress. Even while doing it, you don't know what the right answers are, what the right measures are. You're just figuring it out and hoping that your heart, your soul, that pure rage that you feel inside will keep you on the right track.
So, Devashish, we had a few months ago, there's this another independent filmmaker. Her name is Alisha Tejpal.
She's a friend.
Oh, great. Lovely. One of the best conversations we have had in Abstract with a filmmaker. Some of the people who are here might agree to me. So, we also discuss a lot about privilege, about cinema and lens and... I'm sure you might know, she's well aware about everything around, and apart from cinema, involvement raha hai unka. She mentioned this one thing which I found very unique. I'm obviously paraphrasing, but she had mentioned that it is sort of false when we say that cinema is a universal language, that everybody sees cinema in the same manner, and it's pure human emotions in a certain sense. Sab log relate karte hain, waise karte hain. She said that there are way too many structures, there are way too many intersections that come in the middle before you actually reach that core human emotion. And, you know, it's not the same for everyone. Cinema is not the same for everyone. Totally alag rehta hai. But what is your take on that? Because your films also explore structures and intersections between different identities. Aapka kya understanding as a viewer also, I am asking, and as a filmmaker also.
No, she's bang on. And again, I'll hark back to that difficult conversation that happened between me and one of the viewers at your offline screening of my films, where the viewer, she questioned me on how much I actually understand of the tribal situation, to be sort of perpetuating some things in my film that reveal my gaze to be a privileged gaze. So what Alisha says, I don't know what the context was in which you guys were discussing it, but what I'm understanding for myself is that, like when, say, the film Joram, and actually none of these films that are around the Adivasi situation were screened today, but one of my newer short films, a film called Cycle. So these are films when I am asked, when I'm questioned or put in the dock, and I wrote a novel called Unga, which was again around the same Adivasi conflict, mining, development situation. When I'm questioned about whether I feel that I've got things right, when I'm representing a section of people that I don't belong to, in my defense, what I often say, and then I wonder if it is a fair enough defense, is that I'm not making this film for the section that I'm representing in the film. I'm making it for a section that probably I come from, who are not sensitized enough to the people who I'm trying to represent in the film. Case in point, say my novel, Unga. So I had a really beautiful conversation, it's online, with a group called Trilingo, which is a group of Adivasis who sort of try and have dialogue around the death of the tribal languages and tribal culture. So they read Unga and they loved certain things and they had issues with certain things. And we had a very difficult and complex conversation about the book. So when all of these things were left behind, appropriation and wrong representation and my privileged lens that I see things through, I arrived at the fact that if I had actually written this book for an Adivasi to read, in their language, I wouldn't have written it in English. So my whole objective, because I'm feeling guilt and I'm feeling like I'm from a section that is almost desensitized because of our privilege to what people who are not privileged enough go through, I'm trying to write stories and make films for people of my class to sort of shake them up, to open up their third eye, to witness, acknowledge, and feel for those who haven't had the same privilege as them. So my question was, is that wrong? So then the subset to that is what Alisha said, that a film comes with so many invisible, inherently built-in structures that you're not even consciously building in, that my film has a very different experience for a privileged audience vis-a-vis an audience that's actually being represented in the film. So that only Adivasi in that room when we did the offline screening of Cycle had such issues with the film that her hands were shaking when she was talking to me. She was so angry. So that film is not a universal language. It's a very, very limited language. Anyone who feels that films, surpasses geographical boundaries has got it very wrong. So I think it's not wrong to do what you're doing as a filmmaker, but what Alisha says is right. We need to be, I think, very, very cognizant and sensitive of the fact that different audiences will respond differently. And maybe then to work towards clarity about who are you making those films for and how sensitive you need to be then for those people who are consuming your film when you've not made it for them. For example, the other film I made, Cheepatakadumpa, the sort of coming of age sexual comedy. Now, there are some women who've had issues like one of the protagonists in the film who get a little triggered by Cheepatakadumpa. And again, in my defense, in my earlier conversation, I say, okay, but I didn't make it for you. And that woman would say, then how are you ensuring that I get filtered out? So I said, there's a trigger warning in the beginning of the film. Other than that, how can I control the film on YouTube? You read the trigger warning, it gives you a fair warning that if you think that the contents of this film will trigger you in some way, please feel free to stop watching. But even that is probably not enough. Again, I'm a work in progress. I'm trying to figure out how much more sensitive can I be? How better can that sensitivity then sort of be assimilated into filters and conversations and consuming devices? I don't know. It's just a very complex conversation. But yes, she's right. A film is not a universal language, quite like literature, because literature also needs translation and adaptation. If it has to transcend the boundaries of language, so does film.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a lot more invisible, because with literature, it's literally a book written in Spanish by Gabriel Garcia Marquez has to be translated to English for you to read it. But with a film, a Spanish film, okay, there are subtitles, but there's still a lot of visual cues there that you will understand differently from a Spanish person who has lived the Spanish culture all his or her life. So how does that get adapted? I don't know.
Sometimes even the same film, which might be more dramatic and something which might be much more subtle in that regard, dono ka shayad message same hoga, but the form in which they are made makes already filters out the audience in that regard. I believe. So the nuance is also sort of...
And filtering is a two-way process. And there are audiences that filter out certain things that unke radar pe nahi padi. Aur tumko laga ki, yaar, ye to itna loud dala, maine ye radar pe kaise nahi padi. But wo bhi to apne cultural lens ke saath aayenge na. So a film, more than... Like, again, what is interesting about a film and therefore dangerous and therefore complicated is that unlike most other art, ek kitab aap likh lete ho aur wo ek shelf pe hai aur koi utha kar pad leta hai. पीस ऑफ आर्ट बना लेते हो, एक गाना बना लेते हो, कभी ना कभी कहीं ना कहीं कोई सुन रहा है, देख रहा है, आप उसमें इन्वॉल्व नहीं हो. बट विद अ फिल्म ऑफन, स्पेशली इन द मॉडर्न वर्ल्ड विद व्हाट वी आर डूइंग राइट नाउ, इट्स अ टू वे डायलॉग मच मोर देन अदर आर्ट फॉर्म्स. एंड देर आर ऑल्सो लिविंग ब्रीदिंग पीपल इन दैट फिल्म दैट आर मेकिंग यू फील सर्टन थिंग्स बिकॉज यू आर वॉचिंग अ ह्यूमन बींग, यू आर वॉचिंग एन इम्प्रेशन ऑफ योर सेल्फ इन सम फॉर्म. So it's a dialogue, whether you like it or not. And that much more, therefore, sensitivity as a filmmaker, that much more leeway to be open to figuring out what impact you're having on different kinds of audiences. So it's a very complex beast of film. And anyone who treats it lightly, I feel, is doing a disservice to the medium.
Essentially, when you speak about portraying different classes in your film, where which are necessarily not what you've grown up with or what you've experienced firsthand. And when you're portraying the story, there's a responsibility. But apart from films like, say, Cheepatakadumpa, or maybe, for example, even certain films here like Elaichi, when you're making these films portraying different people, essentially, does that filmmaking become an act of sort of expiation, an act of self introspection and self thing, so to say, because of sort of like an induced guilt of being alien or being foreign to sort of this world, and hey, my filmmaking is a way to cleanse my sins. So as Terence Davies and Terence Malick said, filmmaking for them is going to church, but they were Catholics trying to find the spirit and the Holy Ghost in 24 frames per second. So for right. you, what is that feeling? Is it religious? Is it holy? Is it sort of like a distillation of society, or is it a denuding of human nature? What is it?
No, it is partly what you said. It is partly trying to absolve myself of some of that guilt, hopefully because every film I have made, I will not speak for other filmmakers. I'm sure all filmmakers on all films have a tough time. But every film I have made has been a producing, financing nightmare. Every film, including a small film like Agli Baar, has broken me in ways that I didn't imagine, because these films are really hard to first find any kind of resources for, then convince 20, 30, 70, 100, 250 people to come in for almost no resources and give their lives for. And it's like going to war. So I use a war analogy for my films a lot. And then after that, to find audiences for. Like, it's been 8 years since Agli Baar has been out, and I'm still trying to get audiences to watch it and engage with it and showing up when they do. That's part of it. The other is, like I said, like if I don't belong to a certain section of people and I'm curious about what makes them tick. And when I say curious, I'm genuinely curious, because I'm so disinterested in my own antecedents that I'm that much more interested in other people's ethnological history. So it becomes like an ethnological study for me. It's like going to a practicals class and indulging in practicals and not just theory. So it becomes that very enriching experience for me to get to know more. Hence my constant usage of the phrase work in progress. Because I'm like, while making a cycle, while writing an Unga, while making a Joram, I was, with every subsequent project, I'm getting a little closer to the Adivasi, to understanding the Adivasi identity. I don't claim to ever know it completely, because I was not born one. But I'm getting to know it a little more with every project. I could go there and travel there for 20 years through all those areas, or I could keep telling stories, and through every story, I'm pushed to get to know more. So for me, it's that. It's like going to school and studying ethnography. Alongside that, it's also like absolving myself of the guilt of the little privilege that I was born with.
There are two questions that I want to ask. One is, while looking at your films, watching your films, I figure out like, there is always an element of freedom in it, be it physical, sometimes it's physical, sometimes it is mentally for the characters. I want to know your thoughts on your film Rahim Murge Ki Matro. How did you start it? Like, what was the initial thoughts behind that film? And second question would be, sir, when you write, so this is what I am experiencing in my writing journey also for like 2-3 years now. Sometimes people say you write whatever you want to write, setups and everything, and don't limit yourself and don't think about logistic or budgets at the start. But when I wrote a couple of scripts, I figured out like, while pitching, I mean, it definitely helps when you are keeping those budgets, logistics, few location in your mind. So what is your process about it? Like, when you write it, do you keep these things in mind initially, or what's that the process initially and later you figured out, no, I have to mold it like that?
So I'll answer your second question first, because this is my favorite topic. And most screenwriters, especially in Bombay, I'm not counting you in that, Kamal, but most of the writers I've known, my peers, and even a lot of the younger writers that I meet over the years, the fact that they have written a script, because that first script that comes out of you is hard, because you feel ki it's like Everest, ki main upar pahunchte pahunchte mar jaunga. It feels so difficult to finish that first draft of your first script. But the minute that script is written, I've often seen that writer feels entitled ki yaar, maine script likh li. Ab to koi paise dalo, ye film banni chahiye. Ab kisne decide kiya bhai ki ye banni chahiye? Tum chahte ho ki ye bane? Tum chahte ho ki log aakar dekhe? Tum chahte ho ki ye film kamaye paise? Tum hi chahte ho. Puri duniya mein koi nahi chahta. तो अगर तुम ही चाहते हो तो तुम ही इसको एनेबल करोगे ना, कोई और पैसे क्यों डालेगा. एंड द मिनट यू स्टार्ट थिंकिंग लाइक दैट, बिकॉज दैट्स द मोस्ट लॉजिकल वे टू अप्रोच योर स्क्रिप्ट, दैट यू वांट टू सी गेट इट मेड. नोबडी इन द वर्ल्ड एट दैट पॉइंट वांट्स टू सी योर फिल्म मेड, एंड इवन आफ्टर इट्स मेड ओनली यू वांट्स इट टू बी वॉच्ड until it gets out there and proves itself. So if you are the one who wants it written, you are the one who wants it made, you are the one who wants it watched, you are the one who has to make it, empower it and get it made. And for that, you have to think about how much is it going to cost? How difficult is it going to be to get it made? How tight you can make it? How many resources do you have that you can use? Can you work those resources into your script? Agar aapne wo nahi kiya aur aapne ekdam free mind se likha, aapke dimag mein jo aaya likha aur film nahi bani, only you are responsible for the film not getting made, nobody else. Because cinema is the only artistic medium that requires a lot of other people's money. And often a lot of filmmakers don't give that enough respect. It's not your money, it's somebody else's money. It might be Ambani's money. You can say, he's got so much of it, why can't he give me a little bit? But he and his father busted their ass to make that money. You are not in any position to decide what they should do with that money. So for example, Agli Baar. To meri kuch 18-19 feature film shelf hui. उन 6-8 सालों के दौरान, until I hit 2014 and I said, you know what, fuck it, I'm going to make short films. So I made Elaichi first. और Elaichi मैंने, क्योंकि मैं इतने सालों से फिल्म बनाना चाहता बना नहीं पाया, suddenly I got a chance to make this 5-minute film and I got some good actors, I got a very good DOP, I got a great sound designer. I said, I want to shoot it on a red epic. What I didn't realize is that red epic comes with a lots of fucking lights and it requires a lot of time for setup because it's a big and therefore a sensitive camera. So what I envisioned as a one-day shoot became a 2.5-day shoot. What I envisioned as a 50,000 rupee film became a 1,25,000 rupee film. And I spent rent money for a year to make Elaichi. I said, I'm not repeating this mistake ever in my life. So Agli Baar, my whole approach to Agli Baar was, mere paas kya hai? So I realized that mere paas camera ke naam pe, mere flatmate ka mobile phone hai, kyunki mere paas smartphone 3 saal pehle tak nahi tha. मेरे पास एक लैपटॉप है, तोशिबा का पुराना लैपटॉप है जिसका वेब कैमरा है. अब मैं फोन कैमरा और वेब कैमरा के साथ क्या कहानी लिख सकता हूँ, क्योंकि तब आई विल नॉट हैव टू स्पेंड मनी. सो आई मेड Agli Baar इन 25,000 रुपीज बिकॉज आई वर्क बैकवर्ड फ्रॉम द रिसोर्सेज आई हैड. आई कुड हैव रिटन अनदर Elaichi एंड आई वुड हैव नॉट हैड द मनी टू मेक इट. सो आई से दिस ऑफन दैट यू हैव टू बी वेरी विजिलेंट, कॉग्निजेंट एंड वर्क टुवर्ड्स अ स्क्रिप्ट विथ ऑल ऑफ दीज रिसोर्सेज दैट यू थिंक यू कैन ब्रिंग इन एंड यू थिंक यू कैन. इतना तो आप रेज कर ही सकोगे, इतनी छोटी फिल्म तो कोई बना ही लेगा. अंटिल यू रीच अ पॉइंट वेयर पीपल वांट टू गिव यू मनी, अंटिल देन आई डोंट यू नो इफ दैट विल कम बिकॉज आई एम 4 फीचर्स डाउन एंड पीपल स्टिल डोंट वांट टू गिव मी मनी टू मेक अ फिल्म. यू हैव टू थिंक अबाउट रिसोर्सेज, यू कांट लेट योर माइंड वांडर कि मेरे दिमाग में ये विजन है. वो तुम्हारे दिमाग में ही है, दुनिया को नहीं चाहिए, तुमको ही चाहिए. यू हैव टू एम्पावर योरसेल्फ. और बहुत ही आयरोनिक चीज होती है इस इंडस्ट्री में, आप स्क्रिप्ट लिख के जाते हो, आपने रत्ती भर प्रोडक्शन नहीं किया होगा पूरी जिंदगी, आप शायद फिल्म स्कूल से भी नहीं हो, आप बंबई आ गए, आपने स्क्रिप्ट लिखी, आप प्रोड्यूसर के पास जाते हो कि मैंने स्क्रिप्ट लिखी है. द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन एनी प्रोड्यूसर इन ऑल ऑफ दिस कंट्री विल आस्क यू, बजट क्या है? एंड यू बी लाइक, अरे हाउ डू आई नो, आई डोंट नो हाउ टू मेक बजट. यू हैव टू ब्रेक इट डाउन एंड टेल मी व्हाट द बजट इज. एंड दे लाइक, नो, इफ यू डोंट टेल मी व्हाट इट कॉस्ट यू, हाउ कैन आई टेल यू इफ आई कैन मेक इट. तो ये चिकन और एग सिंड्रोम हो जाता है कि पहले चिकन आया कि एग आया. तो वो रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी भी आपकी है, आपको डिसाइड करना पड़ेगा कि ये कितने में बनेगी, क्योंकि लोग पूछेंगे आपसे और आपने कहा कि ये तो मैंने अपने फ्री माइंड से लिखा और दिस इज हाउ आई वांट टू सी इट और ये 22 करोड़ की फिल्म है. दे विल बी लाइक, भाई जाओ, जहां से आए थे वापस जाओ, कभी वापस मत आना. क्यों देगा कोई इतने पैसे तुमको? और इसमें पहला सवाल क्या था, सॉरी मैं भूल गया, कैरेक्टर्स की फ्रीडम. हाँ, तो 2-3 चीजें थी. रहीम मुर्गे पे मथुरा इज द फर्स्ट शॉर्ट फिल्म आई एवर रोट, आई थिंक 2005 या कुछ में लिखी थी. फिर उसमें भी 2008 में बनी, बट वो 20,000 या 21,000 रुपए खर्च हो गए फिल्म पे. वो 20,000-21,000 रुपए जुटाने में 2 साल लग गए, सोचो, इतनी गरीबी थी. तो एज अ चाइल्ड, लाइक आई सेड, द काइंड ऑफ मोहल्ला आई ग्रू अप इन, तो हर ईद पे उस जमाने में बड़े बड़े गाय कटते थे, वो बिल्कुल मेरे घर के सामने. तो मैंने हलाल अपनी पूरे बचपन में मैंने बहुत हलाल होते हुए देखा, एंड आई एम वेरी क्यूरियस अबाउट हलाल. समहाउ इट नेवर टर्न मी ऑफ, आई जस्ट I'm fascinated by that whole idea of halal. It has a certain religious idea, but that's not the idea I'm interested in. I'm interested in the idea of jo Rahim Murge pe Mathuro ko lekar maine kaafi interviews mein ek word use kiya, anthropocentrism. Now, anthropocentrism is the idea of placing man at the center of everything. Ki agar aap environment ki baat karo ya क्लाइमेट की बात करो या जानवर की बात करो या पंछी की बात करो, किसी भी चीज की बात करो, इंसान अपने आप को ही सेंटर में रखता है कि मेरे को लकड़े की जरूरत है घर बनाने, मेरे को पानी की जरूरत है पीने को, मेरे को जानवर की जरूरत है खाने को या फार्मिंग करने को, पर इंसान अपनी जरूरत के लेंस के थ्रू ही हर चीज को देखता है. तो इन दिस वर्ल्ड एवरीथिंग एंड एवरी अदर स्पीशीज हैज बिकम रिसोर्स. वी डोंट रियली, ऑफकोर्स आर फिलोसफीज आर वेरी grand and we are the most intelligent creature on the planet, so we philosophize a lot about the consciousness of other beings, but we don't really think about them when we need resource. When we get hungry, we don't think about those other creatures consciousness. So Rahim Murge Mein Mathru was an exploration of that. So usko ek insaan ki awaaz dekar I was trying to explore ki ye janwar ultimately resource banne wala hai. So I saw it as this ironic journey ki usko insaan ka consciousness dekar हम इंसान को कह रहे हैं कि भाई मैं तुम्हारे लिए हलाल होने में मेरे को कोई गम नहीं. तो इट वाज ट्राइंग टू बी अ आयरोनिक स्लैप इन द फेस टू ह्यूमन बीइंग्स.
हेलो सर, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई लाइक टू से आई एम अ ग्रेट एडमायरर ऑफ योर वर्क. आई वाज फर्स्ट इंट्रोड्यूस्ड टू योर फिल्मोग्राफी थ्रू तांडव एंड द लास्ट डांस ऑफ मनोज बाजपेयी वाज वेरी मच फैसिनेटिंग. डांस के थ्रू भी इमोशन था उसमें, एक जो वेंट आउट हो रहा. एक्चुअली मेरे दो सवाल है. पहला है अज्जी को लेके. अज्जी इज आई थिंक इट इज वन ऑफ द बेस्ट रिवेंज स्टोरी. सो अज्जी में एक पर्टिकुलर सीन है जहाँ एक मैनिक्विन को डिसमेंटल किया जाता है एंड दैट रिप्रेजेंट्स द एक्ट ऑफ मोलेस्टेशन. तो उसके बारे में वो विजुअल रिप्रेजेंटेशन.
सो सुषमा ताई एंड हैड अ वेरी डिफिकल्ट नाइट दैट नाइट वी शूटिंग द मैनिक्विन सीन. सो देयर वर two things why the mannequin. So the fact that people saw this film as a rape revenge film and not more than that, because somewhere you try to layer your film with a lot of social commentary and you try to say a lot of things, but ultimately when it's packaged and marketed, it needs to be a certain kind of film for audiences to come to it. So it ended up being called a rape revenge film, but I don't think I made a rape revenge film. I made a film that was trying to say a lot of things. And in most rape revenge films, there is a certain exploitative way that the woman's body or the even the idea of a woman being raped is sort of explored. It's I don't know if a lot of those films in this particular C film or B film genre in America where the rape revenge thing was invented, I don't know if those films really did a service to the discourse around brutality against women. So somewhere all of that was playing on our minds, Mirat, my co-writer, and me, when we were trying to see how in this film, because this little girl gets raped, that doesn't happen in the duration of this film. It's already happened. So how do we show, if we want to show, this man who is a rapist as the monster that he is, how do we show that without objectifying a woman's body or even, for that matter, even showing a woman's body in frame? How do we abstract it, given that you're called the abstract room? So I'll now, lead with the word abstract. So the word was really abstract. How do we abstract it? And that's where the idea of a mannequin came, that why don't we use a proxy to see the horrific lengths that this man can go to, and then let the audience imagine what it could be if it was a woman there instead of a mannequin. So the other thing that this achieves, I think, I may be wrong because I can't inhabit everyone's mind to know what they're imagining when they are seeing the mannequin scene. If there is a man in the room whose gaze is incorrect, for lack of a better word, I'm being a little oversimplistic here, then when he sees that mannequin as a proxy for a woman, his mind would go to things that that are exploitative. And that itself for me is a social experiment. Ki maine tumko dikhaya nahi, but agar tumne aise socha, that's your bad. But my gaze is not going to be exploitative or fetishizing. So that was an experiment. Now, did I succeed or not? I don't know. But the endeavor was to abstract it so that the onus is then on the viewer to complete that with their imagination. Then those who are guilty of having imagined it a certain way, it's on them. I didn't show it. The second subtext to the mannequin is really what Ajji is doing through the story. You know, she's going and chopping meat. And in that meat shop, you see a goat being taken into little pieces. You know, ultimately, it becomes what? It becomes its arms and its legs and its head and its kidney and its kapura. Ultimately, it gets taken apart. And it's okay for an Ajji to take a goat apart because she wants to take revenge on a human being. So somewhere that anthropocentrism of even an Ajji who you're rooting for, but she's equally guilty of anthropocentrism as all of us are. So somewhere the mannequin became a human proxy for even the other creatures that we tear into little bits to turn them into our resource. So that mannequin started working at many levels for us as subtext.
And the second question would be about Bhonsle. So the whole film is, I think, it takes the static cam of, means the camera does not move. It takes the static, means shots of Manoj Bajpayee and explores his loneliness. But at the last shot where he hits the man in the bathroom, the camera, it gives a jerk, means camera becomes handheld, and it continuously becomes handheld until he kills that man. So why it was that deliberate choice?
So I understand what you're saying, but if you are saying that the whole film was static and the end was handheld, then probably I have failed as a director. Because the whole film was actually handheld. Only in the end, it becomes a lot more dynamic. Because in the climax, it's peak points of view. So the camera is actually rigged to helmets on the actor's heads. So when he's beating him, it's literally, it's his head is moving and it's his POV. And when he's getting beaten, it's his POV. So the entire climax is played off on points of view. Therefore, it becomes more dynamic because I wanted the audience to feel the energy of that violence in that small space. But the rest of the film also, yes, I know what you're saying, that it feels static maybe because the character is static, but the camera is constantly handheld. It moves slowly, yes, not as dynamically as it does in the climax, but the whole film is handheld. Only in the climax, because it goes into points of view and it's not objective, it just becomes a lot more, it's feeding off the energy of the actor because the actors are really aggressive in that scene. So the camera becomes really aggressive. So it was really Bhonsle for me was more of an exploration of the violence intrinsic to people than Ajji was. Because in Ajji also, the protagonist is not a violent woman. She just had a lot of repressed rage, which comes out in a violent act. But in Bhonsle, in the whole film, it was an exploration of all kinds of violence. It was cultural violence, gender violence, the age gap violence, because Bhonsle, despite at some point starting to have an affinity to Sita and Lalu, initially is constantly violent with them. He shuts doors in their faces. He speaks rudely. So it was an exploration of all kinds of sociological violence. Even within closed doors, he's also being violent towards himself. He's like, if I don't get this job, I don't care if I'm dying of a brain tumor. I don't want this life. I want to die on my job. So there's a self-inflicted, you know, violence of the soul. So that handheld camera at all times keeps changing energy. So if you see when the camera is with Vilas inside his taxi, it's fairly dynamic. It goes with his energy. It's a smaller camera. It's inside the taxi. It's moving with the taxi. So it's all trying to, the camera is constantly trying to tap into the violence intrinsic to all these characters. So in the climax, when the violence reaches that head, where the both of them are so frustrated that they're okay beating each other's heads to smithereens, then the camera is also taking on that energy because it's been taking on that energy right through the film leading up to this confrontation.